I'm Charles Tart. I am a psychologist with a special interest in transpersonal psychology, parapsychology, altered states of consciousness. I'm interested in the human mind, basically, and perhaps what you might like to call the human soul, and what we can find out about it, what it means for our lives. My definition of transpersonal psychology relates it to the idea of a soul. Okay, ordinary psychology is defined as the study of behavior, as if it's caused entirely by electrochemical reactions in the brain. But I use soul in the very old-fashioned sense of the term, of something different from just our physical aspect, something that might survive death, something that's responsible for our spiritual nature. Put it more generally, what it's formally defined as is taking that prefix trans, T-R-A-N-S, to mean things that are beyond our personal self. Ordinarily, I sit here, I'm in a body, I have a social identity, I have a particular personal history, I have my habits, my hopes and fears and all that. I'm very constricted and located at this point in space and time. But people have transpersonal experiences, spiritual experiences, where they feel as if there's something much bigger than just their ordinary biological identity. Transpersonal psychology is the study of those experiences, learning how to induce them, learning how to train them, trying to understand what they mean. Put it another way, transpersonal psychology is about trying to make the spiritual real and effective in contemporary life. You know, some people can pick up an old spiritual system, an old religion, and have it work for them. And for an awful lot of people, it doesn't work. You know, it might have worked for people in the 1800s or the 800s or something like that. But we need a spirituality that works for people who live in the 21st century. And that's one of the main jobs of transpersonal psychology, to sort through all these things we've inherited and find, this is so full of cultural artifacts, it's not going to work here. This is the essential practice, which does work here, and learn how to make that stuff work well. So, you know, I don't want to say that in a messianic kind of way, because there is a real scholarly bent here, and we want to get at the truth, not just emotional satisfaction, but the truth. But we have a general confidence that the truth is that we are spiritual beings, and that part of us needs to be nourished and grow. I came into psychology close to 50 years ago now. Psychology was very behavioristic in its orientation. Psychologists wanted to be real scientists, and they wanted to be objective, and people's experiences were considered subjective, and so you couldn't study them scientifically. So the emphasis was on behavior, which was fine as a partial view, but as a total view of human nature was sort of silly. Because most of the most interesting and meaningful things in life are experiences that happen inside, not external behavior. Well, I wasn't buying that orientation. I figured psychology in the old-fashioned sense was the study of the human mind, and behavior was one aspect of it, but only one aspect. So I became interested in things like hypnosis and altered states of consciousness, and thought it's a good thing that people could talk, that you can ask them about their experiences. Of course, there are difficulties. You know, people don't describe things very accurately sometimes. But better to go at the important stuff and deal with the difficulties as they come up than to simplify the field so much that it's very objective but kind of trivial, which is where psychology was. Now, 50 years later, there's a lot of improvement, but not enough. Consciousness is a somewhat respectable thing for people to study now. But it's still being conceived of as too narrow a way. You know, there's a problem with psychologists. We're insecure. We'd like to be real scientists like physicists and chemists and all those people. And so there's a tendency to copy the methods of the physical sciences. And that works real well for a few things, but it leaves out most of the most interesting subject matter. So as I say, most psychologists are still insecure in copying the physical sciences stuff too much and ignoring the most important things. So for example, consciousness is a much more respectable thing to study now if your emphasis is on what are the brain correlates of consciousness. Because the brain is physical and objective, and you can measure it with machinery, and it looks very scientific and all that. And that leads to a kind of reductionism of bringing everything down to it's produced by the brain, which I think is actually not only scientifically inaccurate, but bad for human beings. If you're told essentially you're nothing but a meat computer, which is the materialistic, reductionistic sort of view, it's not only scientifically inaccurate, it doesn't do much for the human spirit. It doesn't do much to make you want to move forward in life or to look at the spiritual side of things. So in that way, psychology is still kind of not good for people in too many ways. Back in 1975, I had a book coming out, an anthology I put together, which was called Spiritual Psychologies. And it was based on the idea that in the many spiritual systems I've studied, every one of them had a psychology embedded in it, a whole set of ideas about the nature of the mind and how we learn things with it and what we do with it and what's healthy and whatnot. And I wanted to get people to write about their spiritual traditions as psychologies to make it more accessible to us. Well, the book was going off to the printers, and I got a call from my editor, and he said, I have good news and bad news. The good news is that the major psychology book club wants to adopt the book as its main selection when it comes out. I was very happy. That's wonderful. The bad news is that they say psychologists cannot handle the word spiritual. They'll just freak out. They can't do it. Can we call it something else? I said, right. We'll call it transpersonal psychologies. The word is almost synonymous, but at that time, nobody had heard of the word transpersonal, so people didn't have this conditioned reaction of, oh, that's weird, spiritual kind of stuff. So the book became Transpersonal Psychologies instead of Spiritual Psychologies. But that old word spiritual sums up a lot of what transpersonal is about. When people talk about altered states of consciousness, they sometimes mean something quite specific and meaningful, and sometimes they use the words in a real loose way that doesn't convey anything. I mean, sometimes they talk about state of consciousness to mean whatever's on your mind at the moment. Well, in that case, there's an infinite number of states of consciousness, and it doesn't mean anything. But I talk about states of consciousness as specific ways your mind is organized. The way your mind works when you're dreaming is quite different from the way it works in your ordinary waking state. It's quite different from if you're really angry, or quite different than if you're depressed, or quite different than if you're hypnotized. Those are all discrete, by which I mean separately formed, separately functioning states of consciousness. So I've tried to get people to describe these things better and to recognize when a state of consciousness is discretely different from another. So, for example, a state of anger, which is an altered state of consciousness if it's real strong. It's not if it's a little being peeved off at something, but if it's real strong. It might be very fine for defending yourself from a wild animal. Not at all fine for making up a lover's quarrel. What you can do, how you see the world, is affected by the state of consciousness you're in. So it behooves us to learn to recognize what state we're in, what's appropriate to do and not to do when we're in that state, and if we're in the wrong state for the situation we have to deal with, to try to bring ourselves into the appropriate state of consciousness for working with the situation. So for most of my work in altered states of consciousness, for instance, I've tried to experience at least something of particular states so I have an inside idea of what it's about. If you don't have an inside idea, you can do awfully silly things. If you took a behaviorist approach to psychedelic drugs like LSD, for instance, you would probably say that most of the time they act like a sedative or a tranquilizer because people sit still and don't do anything for a long time. And that's not what's happening. In thinking about altered states of consciousness, it became clear to me that we ordinarily make an assumption that our ordinary mental state is sort of the ultimate rational sensible state. And everything I've learned about the way the mind works says that's not true. It's an interesting state. It's very good for a variety of things. It's not so good for other things. There are altered states of consciousness that are a rearrangement of the way the parts of the mind work that are better for some things than ordinary consciousness and worse than ordinary consciousness for other kinds of things. That's what I mean by altered states of consciousness. Now, science is an activity where we try to understand the nature of ourselves in the world. And we think of it as being practiced exclusively in our ordinary state of consciousness, where we're rational and objective and all that sort of thing. In actual fact, the inspirations in science often come in altered states of consciousness, but nobody talks about those. So what I proposed back in the 1970s was that we create state-specific sciences. That is, recognizing the mind as a tool. If someone's in an altered state, they have a different kind of tool that can do different things. Let's do science in those altered states. Let's find out what the world looks like from those kind of altered states, what kind of conclusions we come to. Not that any of those are necessarily better than ordinary state science, but they're different perspectives, and every perspective probably has something that contribute to our overall understanding. If you do something like, say, meditative practice within Buddhism, to take a particular example, you learn to change your consciousness in quite important ways and to investigate your mind from that altered perspective and to come up with different ideas about who you are, what the world is like, and so forth. So people have asked me the question, is that a state-specific science? Sounds like it. People get in an altered state, make observations, come up with ideas. Sounds like the basic stuff. And I'm not sure it is. I think it's actually a state-specific technology. If you think about it, when we think of a scientist, we think of someone who's asking fundamental questions and willing to question anything to see what's really true. Whereas technicians, they're told, the world is this way, now make it work efficiently in this part of it. I suspect something like Buddhism may be more like a state-specific technology. The framework is given as to what the world is like, and your job is to learn to function in that and achieve a certain kind of personal salvation, a certain kind of enlightenment within those parameters. So I'm not sure we have any state-specific sciences yet, except maybe mathematics. Several mathematicians have written to me, actually, that when they do mathematics, they're in a very funny state of consciousness. What they write up later in their journals has to make sense in an ordinary state of consciousness, but that's not how they actually do it. So I think certain kinds of mathematics may already be state-specific sciences. One of the things that happened in the late 50s and early 60s of the last century was that people had realized that ordinary social goodies don't lead to a deep enough happiness. They had the money, they had the sex, they had the jobs and all that, and they wanted more spiritual meaning. People were further finding out in our culture that for too many of them, our old religions didn't work. They told you to be good or else. They didn't tell you how to be good. They tended to manipulate you through fear, and that wasn't going down very well with a lot of people. And then along came psychedelic drugs. And all of a sudden, first hundreds and then hundreds of thousands of people were having the kind of mystical experiences that were the foundations of religion in the first place. That is, instead of getting it fourth hand, you know, I got it from a preacher who got it from his teachers in seminary school, who got it from his church elders, who got it from the results of a committee meeting 1700 years ago. Instead of that watered down, diluted, secularized kind of stuff, people were going directly